Here's what made Jeremiah weep. But they said, we will not walk therein. Verse 17, also I set a watchman over you. Somebody say, that's the bishop. That's the overseer. Saying, hearken to the sound of the trumpet. Remember when the chapter started, the trumpet was sounding. Warning, flee this, flee that. But they said, we will not hearken. Means we hear, but hearken means we'll not listen, we'll not obey it. We'll not do what he's saying for us to do. Look how the chapter 6, Jeremiah 6 ends. Verse 30, he says, they're reprobate silver. That means they're rejected, refused. There's that word reprobate in the Old Covenant. Found it in the New Covenant earlier as we was preaching from Romans 1. Shall men call them because the Lord hath rejected them? Right there is what reprobate means. You want to know what it means? You've rejected God so long, now God rejects you. You become a reject. What you think it means when he says, behold, I stand at the door and knock. If any man hear my voice, open the door, I'll come in him and sup with him and he with me. Revelation 3:20, he's talking to his own people. That is not a scripture for the world. He's talking to his own people. And by verse 15 and 16, his accusation against them, and it's true, it's accurate. He said, you're lukewarm. He said, I'm going to spew you out of my mouth. That don't just mean the healer got sick and says, I'm about to vomit. But what he was saying, I'm going to eject you. I'm going to reject you.
Say, we'll repent or we'll become reprobate. Notice what verses 1 of chapter 7 of Jeremiah says. The word of the Lord came to Jeremiah from the Lord saying, verse 2, stand in the gate of the Lord's house. Somebody say, that's where preachers are going to be found. They're going to be at the house of the Lord preaching. Amen. And proclaim there. Somebody say, proclaim there. Ain't amazing? Even then, they called the house of the Lord of there a place. This word and say, hear the word of the Lord, all ye Judah, that enter into these gates to worship the Lord. He's done talked about how some of God's people, amen, are comely. They stay at their house. Remember? Remember in Jeremiah 5:2? They at their house. All right? But now right here, he's going to preach to those that do come. Thus saith the Lord of hosts, the God of Israel, verse 3, amend your ways. That's the same as saying repent of your ways and your doings. And I will cause you to dwell in this place. Somebody say, those that really repent, they'll come and they'll be house dwellers. They won't just come every now and then and not come back for a long time and then come again, hit or miss. Somebody say, those that's really amended their ways and their doings that have repented, somebody shout, they'll dwell in his house. That's the reason some folks can't stay in church, because they ain't right with God. They ain't got their heart right. They've not repented. They're in revolt. They rebel. They hear the preacher preach on Sunday morning from social media platforms, and they think, that's not me. I'm not listening to that. That's somebody else. That's not me. And they keep hardening their neck till God's going to give them what they want. And God warned a couple weeks ago in here through that word of judgment. Amen. It took about 18 minutes. God said, I'm about to stop speaking to them. We're right there. He's going to let them have what they want. Verse 4, trust not in lying words. Here's the lying words. And it was their own. They said, the temple of the Lord, the temple of the Lord, the temple of the Lord are these. The temple of the Lord, the temple of the Lord, the temple of the Lord is not there. Here is these. Ain't y'all heard that in the last few years? Oh, we're the church, we're the temple. That ain't nothing new. Jeremiah's weeping. He has set watchmen on the wall warning, saying, flee, repent, amend your ways. And literally, when you study this, this sister, Melissa, this when you study it, I got to turn sideways because I wrote it sideways. Sometimes stuff flowing so much, I ain't got time for pieces of paper after I write it down. And I wrote this a few years back. Because this ain't the first time I've prayed. They thought as long as they went to God's house, God would protect them no matter how they live. The temple of the Lord is these, not there, not an actual place, but it's us. But it also meant that they claimed just four times, temple of the Lord, temple of the Lord. I did, you know, my religious thing. Yeah, for good. I've been to church. I went some. Somehow now that gives me access to all God's, hello, provision and protection and whatever. But everybody say, the temple of the Lord, the temple of the Lord, the temple of the Lord are these. Not there. When you look back up in verses 1 or verses 2, God's telling Jeremiah to stand in the gate of the Lord's house and proclaim there his word. And those that it come, every now and then they're saying, the temple of the Lord are these. And the prophet's preaching there. And they're thinking, just because I go to church every now and then, everything's all right. God, you know, he's my God too. He said, trust ye not in lying words, saying the temple. And so it's lying words. Verses 7, he's telling them still to repent. He's still preaching repentance. And listen to what he says. Then will I cause you to dwell in this place. So he's preaching to people who's saying, we're the temple, we're the temple. They don't dwell in God's house. They're not house dwellers. They don't dwell at God's house. They go every now and then. But they're claiming they're God's. And the prophet's trying to repent, call to them, amend your ways, you're doing repent. And he's calling them to repentance. And he's telling them, you're trusting in lying words, your own words. But he's letting them know, if you'll repent and do what I'm telling you, this is what's going to cause you, somebody to say, to dwell in this place. Now he calls it a place. Somebody say they can't dwell in God's house because they won't repent of their sin. All right? He said, behold, in verses 8, ye trust in lying words that cannot profit. Verse 9, will you steal, murder, commit adultery, and swear falsely, that means lie, and burn incense unto Baal and walk after other gods whom you've not known. Somebody say, this is the doctrine of Baal, the doctrine of Jezebel. It's ancient, but it's still alive and well modernly in 2023. The doctrine of Baal, Baal was, you know, from the neck up was the image of a bull, a literally bull, a bull. Bull. Horns. And from there down, the image of a man's body. This was the god of Jezebel. Baal worship involved both heterosexual and homosexual sexual perverted acts. Sleazy sex, anything goes, anything's accepted. They would throw their newborn babies into burning fires on Baal's altar while their babies were burning. And the Bible called it in Psalms 106, 37 and 38, sacrificing their sons and daughters, shedding innocent blood to demons, to devils. Abortion is Satanism. And anybody that supports it is a Satan worshiper. Don't be deceived. I don't care if they say the temple of the Lord, the temple of the Lord, the temple of the Lord. I go to church or I'm a Christian. Baal. Baal worship. Ain't this amazing? This is the doctrine of Baal. This is the doctrine of Jezebel. The doctrine of Baal says, just like Jeremiah says here, they would not repent when he was telling them to flee, what he was telling them to flee. And he said, and if you would, this is what would cause you to dwell in this place, the house of the Lord. It would cause you to dwell, amen, in the house of the Lord. But the reason you can't get, bound to God's house again, the reason, amen, you can't get connected to God's house again and get established in the household of faith again and be rooted in the house of the Lord, as Psalms 92 and 14 says, he said, because you've embraced this doctrine that tells you you can steal, you can murder, you commit adultery, you can lie, and you can still worship God and still live your old sinful life and just every now and then and do what Jeremiah said here and say, we're the temple of the Lord. The temple of the Lord are these. It ain't a place. It ain't a building somewhere. It's these. I don't have to go to church. I'm saved, but I don't need to go to church. Amen. This is the doctrine of Baal. This is the doctrine of Jezebel. It's ancient. I know we think it's something new that's just come out in the last few years, but this thing's old. Amen. It's ancient. Hallelujah. Amen. It's an old serpent. Anybody hear the Holy Ghost right here in a new year? We're revealing it. amen, and they're burning incense unto Baal. This means they think they're worshiping Jehovah. They think they're worshiping God, but they're really worshiping Baal. Baal's the lust god, the lust of the flesh. Whatever your appetite wants to do, the very only commandment of Satanism given by Anton LaVey, the one who started the Satanist church that wrote the Satan Bible. Amen. Glory to God. Amen. And this is their only command. Do whatever you want. Do what thou wilt. Come on, whatever pleases you, do it. And that's that doctrine. You can still be saved. Do what you want. Say what you want. Live like you want. You don't need to go to church. You're still a Christian. You don't need to live right. Just keep doing what you want. And they walked after other gods, whom you know not. Verse 10 says, and come and stand before me in this house. They're going to live like that, and then every now and then they're going to come into God's house and stand before God in his house. Can y'all see why Jeremiah's weeping? Which is called by name and say, we are delivered to do all these abominations. That's the doctrine of Jezebel. It's connected to Baal worship. They think they're coming in God's house when they do, and we're worshiping Jesus. But God said they're worshiping Baal. Why? Because they say, this is the false doctrine of Jezebel, of Baal. We're delivered to keep on sinning. We'll come to church every now and then, but preacher, stay out of our business. Hello? We're going to keep doing what we want to. We're Christians too. And here's the famous quote. Jesus quoted this from Jeremiah's preaching in verses 11 of Jeremiah 7. Is this house which is called by my name become a den of robbers in your eyes? Jesus called it a den of thieves in Matthew 21:13. You remember that when he run them out? Jesus is quoting from Jeremiah. Jesus quoted the Bible. That's when he preached. He said, behold, even I have seen it, saith the Lord. In other words, God says, you ain't coming in my house thinking you covering it all up. I see it anyhow. They were playing with God. They thought they could come to his house every now and then, Brother Rob, and still just do whatever they wanted to. And oh, after all, we're still Christians. We can do what we want. Somebody says it's the doctrine of Jezebel. It's a false doctrine. Verse 16, God told Jeremiah and told the leaders, don't even pray for this people. Neither lift up a cry nor prayer for them. Neither make intercession for me, for I will not hear. You mean you can go so far, God says, don't even, I have had God, I can count on one hand when God told me not to pray for somebody ever again. I've even had God, I can count on just the first three fingers here. How many times he told me, don't ever preach to them again. Don't never say, and I watched them people die. God would not let me open my mouth and say nothing to them ever again. Wouldn't even let me pray for them. Somebody say, it's in your Bible. And it's also in your New Testament. It's in Romans 1, God gave them up. He gave them up. I'm no longer going to do one. So when the Holy Ghost speaks weeks ago and says, I'm about to stop telling people about coming to my house, I'm no longer going to deal with it. I'm not even let the prophet and the preacher preach much on that no more. I'm not even going to let him say, he's giving them up. I've been hearing the Holy Ghost in the last week of this fast telling me I'm about to give people up. I'm through telling them. I've been telling them through your mouth almost 6 years. And longer than that, I'm just talking about as a pastor. He said, I'm fit to give people up, fitting to let them have what they want. I'm no longer going to warn them. He said, I'm going to concentrate on those that will listen and do what I say, and I'm going to speak to them, and I'm going to use them. He said, but I'm going to stop trying to reach out to those that keep hardening their neck against me. He said, judgment's at the door. They think you're talking to somebody else and it's them. They have went so far into rebellion that they have revolted against my counsel, and God says, I'm about to give them up. Where are you going to hear preaching like this? Just stay tuned. This don't pack the crowds. This ain't popular. But probably neither is Jeremiah 5 through Jeremiah 7. Verse 23, but this command I them, saying, this is Jeremiah 7, verse 23. For year 23, obey my voice, and I will be your God. and you shall be my people. Somebody say, God is not your God if you don't obey his voice. If you don't obey his word. People's doing what Saul did before he fell. We think Saul fell in 1 Samuel 16. We think that's where his fall began in 1 Samuel 13. When he didn't listen to God's counsel to begin with. He didn't wait on God. Then his fall is revealed in chapter 16. And here's what he told Samuel when Samuel rebuked him. The prophet come back and rebuked him. He said, well, I feared the people's voice. I feared the people. He cared more about what people said. Huh? There was his fault. Amen. Yeah. And then the second thing was, he said, I have disobeyed your word and God's word. Somebody said that was his deception. He started separating what God was saying through the prophet from God. He was just saying, oh, that's just Samuel talking. Somebody, you watching right now. You do that all the time. Not just with me, but other preachers. Oh, that's just them talking. You just pick out the parts you like. Oh, that's how Saul fell. Somebody say he lost it, got demon possessed. It don't even show he recovered ever. Obey my voice and I'll be your God and you shall be my people. Listen to this. Here's how you know if you obey God. And walk ye in all my ways that I've commanded you, that it may be well with you. Somebody say, if you obey God, you'll walk with him. You'll do what he says. He said, I'll be your God. Somebody say, until we do what he says and walk the way he said, we're not his and he's not ours. Be not deceived. Verse 24, but they hearken not, nor incline their ear, but walked in the counsel and the imagination of their evil heart. Imagination there translates in Hebrew, literally it means a stubborn imagination. Stubbornness in their mind, an evil heart, and went backward, not forward. Somebody say they went back, not forward. Somebody say because they were stubborn. In Psalm 78 and verses 8, I'm going to preach. Is it okay? I'm going to preach like I ain't going to never get to preach again because I may not. Psalm 78 and verses 8, the Bible said, be not as your fathers were. They were a stubborn, rebellious generation. Somebody say some people have this generational curse on their life, and it's the traditions of men. They can't follow God and walk with God because they're bound by the traditions that make the word of God a none effect in their own life, according to Matthew 15 and 6, as Jesus warned the Pharisees about. Amen. They'd rather stick to their tradition than follow the truth. And anything that contradicts their tradition with the truth, oh, I'm going to go with the tradition. People's more attracted to a tradition in the hour we live than they are the absolute naked truth of God's word. In Psalm 78, God said, don't be like your fathers were. They were a stubborn and rebellious generation whose heart was not aright and they could not walk steadfast with God. Somebody say the reason they couldn't be steadfast with God in their walk because their heart weren't right. They were stubborn. Because in their own imaginations, they counseled themselves. When God spoke through the preacher, oh, that's not for me. Oh, no, God. And then they start counseling their own self. Them's the same ones that say, I don't need a preacher. I don't need a pastor. I can study the Bible for myself. I don't need to go. Stubborn. Psalm 78, Bible said in verse 37, he said they could not walk steadfast in his covenant because their heart was not right with God. Do you know the word steadfast and the word right literally is the same word in Hebrew? Somebody say right means steadfast. So when you say somebody's heart's right with God, you should be seeing somebody who's steadfast with God. Somebody say they're so steadfast. There's a fast the church needs to go on, a steadfast. Come on, somebody. Their heart's so right with God, they're steady with God. They go steady with God. That means they're predictable in the way they live. You can count on them because they're steadfast with God. Somebody say, because it's all from the heart. Their heart's right with God. When people's not steady with God, their heart ain't right. Don't be deceived. Just call it what it is. All right. Verse 25, since the day that your fathers came forth, and by the way, stubborn, break it up, stub. Somebody say stub, born. So it's a generational thing. It's a traditional thing that's connected to fathers. There's somebody before you that's in deception. Amen. Stephen, that's what got him killed, because he preached and he said, you always resist the Holy Ghost as your fathers did. So do you. Amen. Remember that in Acts 7 and 51? And then they picked up stones and went to kill him. Come on. Anybody hear Holy Ghost? Because he rebuked him. He said, the reason you're rebellious because you learned how to be rebellious through somebody before you. Anybody? Well, we didn't do it. Who cares what they did? What is God's word saying? Hallelujah. Don't mean you got to disrespect their memory. Come on, somebody. But if they were deceived, they were deceived. Yeah. Amen. Yeah. Somebody say some traditions are not meant to be kept. Especially when they do not agree with this truth. Amen. And so stub. Stub means to cut off. Means to make something, you know, just cut it off. Cut it out. Stub, it also means stiff. Somebody say something that's stubbed is stiff. Somebody say it's fixed. Somebody say it's inflexible. It's the same as a rebel. That's what stubbed me, a rebel. A rebel at heart, hallelujah. It won't turn either way. And he said a stub born. See, born. So it's connected to a generation of traditions, and people's learn to resist the Holy Ghost. They've learned to rebel against God. And sadly, a lot of times they don't even know they're doing it. And learn to say no to God. But oh, we love Jesus, and oh, the temple of the Lord are these. All right, let's right here. He said, since the day that your fathers came out of the land of Egypt unto this day, I have sent unto you all my servants, the prophets, daily rising up early, sending them. Verse 26, yet they hearken not unto me, nor incline their ear, but harden their neck. They did worse than their fathers. Verse 27, therefore thou shalt speak all these words unto them, but they will not hearken to thee. Thou shalt call unto them, but they will not answer thee. Verse 28, but thou shalt say unto them, this is a nation that obeyeth not the voice of the Lord their God. Here it is. Here's what disobedience. Here's the nature of it. Nor receiveth correction. Truth is perished. Somebody say, when a person can't receive correction in their life, truth perishes. And it's cut off from their mouth. Cut off, again, that's reprobate. That's rejected. That's judgment. Yeah. And God calls them, next scripture in verse 29, a generation of wrath. And it just, you know, goes on and on and on. And I gotta read something before we get through. By the way, Brianna's gonna be preaching tonight. You got a little appetizer this morning when she come out. Hallelujah. You know the famous quote, Isaiah 6:8? Isaiah said, I heard the voice of the Lord saying, whom shall we send and who will go for us? Then said I, oh brother Isaiah, he said, here am I, send me. Isaiah was also a prophet like Jeremiah. God sent him to his own people that were rebellious and stubborn, that would hear the word and say, we're not going to do it. We're not going to listen. We're not going to do it. He said, and go and tell this people, verse 9, hear ye indeed. Hear indeed, that word indeed literally in Hebrew means they hear without ceasing. Constantly they hear it, but they won't do it. Over and over. Why does the preacher keep preaching the same thing over? Because that's how God works. That's God's mercy. People mock it, make fun of it. My God, he keep preaching the same thing again and again. And they don't even realize that they're turning their head at God's mercy. The preacher keeps saying it again and again, keeps preaching the same on it. Why don't they preach something else? That's God's mercy right in front of their face and they can't even see it. Somebody say the preacher keeps preaching it because somebody won't do it. But that time, the cutoff is coming. It's right at us. Hear ye indeed, but understand not. See ye indeed, but perceive not. Verse 10, make this heart of this people fat. That means the wax gross. And make their ears heavy. Shut their eyes, lest they see with their eyes and hear with their ears and understand with their heart. And convert, that means be changed.
and be healed. That's God's judgment right there. God says, I keep telling them, I keep without ceasing, I come, they hear indeed, again and again and again, but they keep revolting and rebelling and rejecting. After a while, God says, I'll just reject them now. And now I'll cause their eyes to be blinded, their ears to be deaf, and their hearts to be shut up, and they won't be converted, so I can change. God says, I'll just say, no, okay, do what you want. Then said I, Lord, how long? This is the same guy that heard God, the Father and God, the Son talking. Who can we send for us? Hear my Lord, I know. Okay, but no, I'm going to send you to people that ain't going to listen. How would you like to call into the ministry to be that way? Go, son, and preach. A lot of them ain't going to hear you. Ain't going to listen to you. Amen. Boy, I got good things in common with some of these prophets. Now he's wanting to ask after God tells him, Lord, how long am I going to preach to them people? I've asked this before. Lord, how much longer? And sometimes I'll be on the way to the pulpit and say, God, not again. Literally. God is my witness. God, not again. How? And the same as saying, how long? And he answered and said, until the cities be wasted without inhabitants, and the houses without man, and the land be utterly desolate. You ever heard old saying, preach them to death? There it is. Isaiah's like, Lord, you want me to keep preaching to them until they all gone? Pretty much. So much for church growth. Verse 12, and the Lord have removed men far away. Somebody says it's judgment. God removed them. Hey, some people ain't left here. God removed them. They thought they moved, but God removed them. Amen. They wouldn't listen. They said one thing with their mouth and did something else with their feet. And they thought God was blessing them, and God removed them. Somebody say, you can move or you can be removed. And the Lord removed men far away. And there be a great forsaking. That's the falling away, the apostasy, the apostate state. Amen. Modernly, we see happening today. A great forsaking in the midst of the land. God started showing me this. In this second Thessalonians 2 and 3, that day will not come except there first be a falling away first. That's a great forsaking. And really, the falling away, the great forsaking in the midst of the land, the people departing from the Lord. It ain't that people's just walking away. God's removing some. He said, I'm through talking to you. I have called to you. I have sent my prophets rising up early, my servants again and again and again and again and again and again, saying, flee, sounding the trumpet again and again. And you just say, I'm the temple. And Isaiah is saying right here, but notice what he said in verse 13. Yet it shall be a tenth. Some might say there's the tithe. And it shall return. Some might say the tenth. Literally means the remnant, the few, the devoted. So God let Isaiah know right here, no, you ain't going to preach everybody out. I'm going to leave you a tenth. I'm going to leave you a tenth. I'm going to leave you a remnant. I'm going to leave you. That's all Jesus ever had, really, was a remnant, was a tenth. It's Acts of 12, but he, that was his foundation. That's all he ever really had. People see all the great followers around you. That's all he ever really had. And one of them forsook him. And he had to put another one in there, Matthias, even after he's raised from the dead when the church was being birthed in Acts 1. Come on, hallelujah. That's all he ever really had was 12. And look what he did with the world with just them 12. Come on, anybody hear the Holy Ghost? Now that's what Isaiah prophesied. Let's read what Jesus was preaching. Somebody's thinking in their mind, boy, we know he ain't preaching tonight, Brianna is, but he's making sure he gets his time in tonight this morning. In Matthew 13, Jesus is preaching to the Pharisees. Verse 14, he says, and in them is fulfilled the prophecy of Isaiah, which saith, by hearing you shall hear,
and shall not understand, and seeing ye shall see and not perceive. Verse 15 says, this people's heart is wax gross. Their ears are dull of hearing. Their eyes have they closed, lest at any time they should see with their eyes and hear with their ears and should understand with their heart and should be converted, and I should heal them. Jesus is preaching to the Pharisees. He's came to his own, John 1:12, and they receive him not. They've rejected him. And he's quoting Isaiah prophesied about you. Huh? Now turn to the last chapter of the book of Acts, Acts 28, as we lead up to the foundation of the vision of this church, this ministry, what it's founded on. In Acts chapter 28, verse 23, here we are in the year 23, let's start in verse 23. And when they had appointed him a day, this is talking about Paul the apostle, he's under house arrest, there came many to him in his lodging, to whom he expounded and testified the kingdom of God, persuading them concerning Jesus, both out of the law of Moses and out of the prophets from morning till evening. Somebody would say, Paul, the prince of preachers. If there was a greater preacher than Jesus or even John, Paul was right up there in the three. Paul would have been. Listen to this. Sister Janice, some believe the things which were spoken, and some believe not. Everybody didn't believe. Somebody say everybody ain't going to believe today either. Preacher, if you're trying to preach to save the world, you're already deceived. They ain't all going to believe. That sounds good, but that ain't even doctrinally. We're to preach the gospel to the whole world. Mark 16:15, it's right there. Amen. But even there in verse 16 said, he that believeth and is baptized be saved, but he that believeth not will be damned. Everybody is not going to believe. I'm not preaching for everybody. And I'm about to stop preaching to some that keep rebelling and keep turning their ear away from God. And I'm not going to waste no more time. I'm not going to wait. I'm about to tell you the cutoff date's coming. And I'm not talking about nothing social media wise or nothing like that. He said, but the cutoff date's coming. I will not reach out to those that I've been telling the same thing again over and over and over, and they will not listen. I'm about to let them do what they want. Judgment is at the door. Some believe and some believe not. And when they agreed not among themselves, somebody shout, that's what Paul's preaching did. It divided the crowds. That's for them dummies that think when they preach, everybody's going to come together because they preached. If you're really preaching, it's a two-edged sword. It's going to cut. It's supposed to divide.
Yes.
Preached on one time, and he said, where you go, you bring division. I said, well, thanks for the compliment. Amen. He preached and people got upset with each other and departed. And after that, Paul had spoken one word. Somebody say, Paul is heard preaching one word as the book of Acts ends. He's preaching one word, not two words, just one word. Well spake the Holy Ghost by Isaiah the prophet unto our fathers. Paul's going all the way back to Isaiah 6. And he tells us who was doing the talking through Isaiah. Somebody say the Holy Ghost. Oh, I like it when he did that. Hallelujah. He's quoting from Isaiah 6. Same place in Matthew 13 where Jesus is quoted from. This is the one word we hear Paul, the last one word of the book of Acts. We think the book of Acts is going to end on a high note with all this power and the church being birthed and miracle signs and more. We think it's going to end on a high note. That's what all them preachers say. Make sure when you preach, end on a high note. Yeah, that's the reason nobody ever says bye, I reckon. Hearing ye shall hear and shall not understand, and seeing ye shall not see. Somebody say this is the last one word Paul preaches in the book of Acts. He preaches from Isaiah 6 now. Verse 27, if their heart of this people is waxed gross and their ears are dull of hearing. Right here, he goes a little bit further and tells us what they're hearing, the reason they can't hear. They're dull of hearing. Tired of hearing preaching. Tired of hearing that. I don't want to hear that no more. My ears is too itchy. I want to hear what I want to hear. You hear? Dull of hearing. Dull is the opposite of being, attentive and desirous and sharp. I want to hear what God. No, I don't want to hear what God says, because if God speaks to me like the old covenant people did in Moses' day in Exodus 20 verse 19, we might die. So preacher, don't preach to me what God's saying, because he requires death when he preaches. You'll preach me to death. I'll get under conviction. I'll have to repent of something. I have to leave. I have to do something. I have to walk down a narrow path. I have to go back to an old walk. Come on, somebody. We don't want to really hear from God. We just want to hear about God, what God's going to do for us. Don't let us hear from him, because that'll require us to have to repent and change and do something different. That ain't too popular. They're dull of hearing that. They don't want to hear that. I don't want to hear that. Somebody say dull of hearing just means the people saying we don't want to hear that. That's the same as them saying we will not hearken. We will not walk therein. We're not going to do what you're telling us. Verse 28. Be it known therefore unto you that salvation of God is sent unto the Gentiles, that they will hear it. God right here says, I'm going to stop speaking to you, and I'm going to go tell somebody else. I'm going to find me somebody to listen. Thank God it happened, or we the Gentiles couldn't have been engrafted in and brought in. Amen. Romans 11, you go there, Paul did tell you about how God's going to bring his people in, the Jews, and many have already, even at this hour. And when he had said these words, somebody say that one word, the Jews departed. Somebody say, my old religious folks got mad and left him. And had great reason among themselves. Verse 30, and Paul dwelt 2 whole years in his own hired house. It was a rented house. He was under house arrest for preaching. They wouldn't let him go outside this house. Didn't stop him from preaching. God brought people to him. He preached, some believed, some not believed. People get mad. Man, you couldn't. In the last scriptures where we founded this ministry on, this is what he did. That one word he preached on. Some's going to believe, some's not going to believe. Some's going to hear and they ain't going to listen. Some's going to see and they ain't going to do nothing I say for them to do. But there it is. You ain't even got to look in your Bible. You can just look up here on the banner. Preaching the kingdom of God. Teaching those things which concern the Lord Jesus Christ with all confidence. No man forbidden him. Think about it. Somebody say preaching. Somebody say the kingdom of God. Teaching. Those things, here it is, which concern the Lord Jesus Christ with all confidence. No man forbidden him. And here it is, Acts 12 and 5, but prayer was made without ceasing of the church and the God. That just simply means a church that prays. So that scripture ends, Brother Rob, with Paul saying, I'm going to preach to a people. A lot of them ain't going to listen, but I'm going to preach anyhow. Right. Amen. Hallelujah. And he says at the end of it, no man forbid me. And that don't just mean Paul, that means the Holy Ghost, because we know Paul was eventually stopped. He gave his life as a martyr. Amen. But somebody shout, the book of Acts, the Acts of the Holy Ghost never stopped. Can I just go ahead and we may just end on a Holy Ghost high here from it, because I can see it right there all written in. When he made that last statement, no man forbidden him, he was encouraging those that did believe. You know, they may only be a tenth left. They may only be a remnant, only a few that'll believe and obey. But God only took 12, only a few, and he turned this world upside down. And we saw the church birthed off of a few that would seek him and pray without ceasing. And he poured out his spirit on all flesh then. And I believe it's a hope to us today that the acts of the Holy Ghost are not through. We are the continuation. Acts 29. Come on, anybody here? I'm preaching vision to you. This is where Pentecost should continue. This is where we should continue to pray. Because somebody shout, the Holy Ghost cannot be stopped. Deaf ears won't stop him. Blind eyes won't stop him. Rebellious hearts and those that are bound with traditions of men can't stop him. So be encouraged, saints of God. The last days are the Lord's days, and he's still going to pour out his spirit. I believe Paul right here in this last verse was preaching to himself. Hello? As he said, oh God, I'm preaching sometime to people that will not listen. He's quoting from Isaiah 6. They will not obey. Hallelujah. With that said, Brianna, play that last song, whatever the next one is the last one. And just let it be the last one is what I'm doing. I don't want to be one of those who wouldn't walk therein. God told them about an old walk, an old path. They'd find rest for their soul if they'd walk down it, but it said they would not walk therein. Jeremiah said they wouldn't hearken. Isaiah said they wouldn't listen. Isaiah 30 verse 15 said, in returning, in confidence will be your rest. In trust and stillness will be your strength. But it said they would not. That's Isaiah 30 verse 15. God told them, return to me, follow me, do what I say, and you'll be blessed by it. But they didn't want it. They didn't want the blessing that way. They wanted the blessing to come and they do what they wanted to. They wanted to keep on doing what was against his will. But God, I want you to bless me. God, I want you to take care of me here. I want to claim your blessings, but God, I don't want to walk no different. I don't want that old walk. Lord, we're in a new year. We need this old walk. We ask for the old paths. Lord, that's the good way. That's the beaten down path. That's the trodden down path. That's the one that the old saints, the old churches used. Lord, we don't need a new cart. We just need an old path. Lord, prepare me to be a sanctuary. Lord, I want to be pure. I want to be holy. Try me so be true. I'm going to tell you, this old path, this old walk, it ain't the sleazy, easy path, the greasy path that many's presenting the day we live in. It's the broad way that the crowds are famously celebrating and attracted to as popular. No, it's a narrow path. It's an old path. It's an old walk. There's some restrictions down this path, but it's going to be eternally worth it. Not only about eternity, this is what brings the outpouring of the Holy Ghost. Yes, sanctify us, Holy Spirit. Separate us, Lord. Oh. Lord, I want to be your sanctuary, pure and holy. Try me so be true with thanksgiving. Lord, I be a living sanctuary for you. Get us ready, Holy Ghost. Lord, I can't help that many have rebelled. I can't help, Lord, that many have revolted. In almost 6 years, Lord, I pray I've pleased you, but I know you're about to change everything. And some of that I ain't gonna have to come to the pulpit and preach no more, because God, you've said enough's enough. And your judgment's at the door, and I'm gonna get to preach some other things. Lord, I pray I've been faithful. Help me to stay faithful. And when I say this, it's not saying that God won't never bring things back up, but I'm finally about to get a release. Where God says, you ain't going to have to say that no more. Not that it don't still need to be said, but God said in John 16 and 12, he even told his disciples, he said, I have many things to say unto you, but you can't bear them no more. You can't bear them. You can't. Sometimes the Holy Ghost will say, just don't say that no more to them, to that one. This one. So in Jeremiah 7, he said, don't even pray for them. They've rebelled against me, and their no prayers an abomination. They won't do what I say. Enough's enough.
The hour's even coming where God's saying, I'm going to you, I ain't even going to let you lay hands on them. You don't even get to pray for them. Because I keep calling out to them, and they won't listen. I don't know about you. I don't want to be one of them. I don't want to be in that category. Remember Jeremiah said that's what the people wanted. And that's what the false prophets and the false priests gave them. The people wanted it that way. And God says, where are you going to be when it all ends? Somebody say, that won't last. I want something that lasts. I want something that's got some eternal distance on it. Come on. Some eternal longevity. I want something that'll last. Hallelujah. My God, thank you, Holy Ghost. God, keep us by your power. Keep us by your presence, oh Lord, in this hour where many have had their minds and hearts darkened and their ears are being covered with scales, or their eyes being covered with scales and their ears are being stopped up by their own ears. Oh, you can't listen to what God's saying if you're too busy putting your finger in your ear, scratching it. Oh, tried and true, Lord. Lord, I want to be living. Lord, I want to be walking, yeah. Somebody say it's time for the old walk, the old path. That's where you'll find rest for your soul. It's a narrow path, yes it is. It ain't the easy, sleazy, greasy, broad way where anything's okay, where the false prophet that's leading people down it is saying peace, peace, when there ain't no peace. Oh, there's persecution down that little narrow path. Oh, there's fights with devils like you ain't never known. Oh, but there's power from another world over those same devils like we could never know except we travel down it. Oh, hallelujah. Thank you, Holy Ghost. God, let us be remembered for the old path. Somebody say, sometimes the old path, the narrow path, you can't get a lot of people on it at the same time. Amen. But there's a remnant. There's a tenth. And from that, God is going to touch the world. Thank you, Holy Ghost. No man forbidden him. Acts 28:31. And I declare over each one of us, no man, no devil, no traditions of men, no plot, scheme of the wicked one, even Jezebel, stop us from doing what you said for us to do. I pray no person will sound of my voice that's truly opened their heart to you. God, I pray they stay with you. I pray they walk with you. I pray they continue with you. I pray they be steadfast with you no matter who, no matter what. God, I pray they become so steadfast and predictable in their walk with you. And Lord, pour out your power, your blessing on them and theirs. And God, keep us, Lord. So everybody say with me as we close, now unto him that is able to keep you from falling and to present you faultless before the presence of his glory with exceeding joy. That's Jude verse 24. Somebody say, now unto him. Hallelujah. Lord, come tomorrow, now unto him. The next day, now unto him. It's not I used to be unto him, it's now unto him. May we be the church unto him, the church unto God that treats every day a new day, now unto him. What we did yesterday, we got to do it now, today unto him. That's the only way we'll keep from falling. God, I pray every person that's hearing my voice, whether they're here or watching, God, those that need to attend and obey, do whatever, God, I pray they would yield to you this day.
Lord Jesus, and they'd be preserved from the judgment. They'd be preserved from the falling. Because those that fall with those that fall, Jeremiah said, would be cut off. And Lord, we don't want to fall with those that are falling away and forsaking your work and your ways and your house and your kingdom in this hour. In Jesus' name, keep us, O Lord. God, I've been praying it for myself, but I pray it for this people, O Lord. Keep us, Lord. Keep us, Lord. Lay hands on somebody before you leave this morning and pray for them. Lord, keep them. Keep them. Amen. And whoever's touching you, you pray back for them. Keep them, Lord. Then you pray one for another. Keep us, Lord. Keep us, Lord. Keep us from what? Somebody say, keep me from falling. Keep me from falling. Keep me, O God. Let him that thinks he stand take heed lest he fall. 1 Corinthians 10:13. God, keep us, O God. Keep us, Holy Spirit. Preserve us, Lord God, blameless to that day when we see you come. And you're soon to come. It could be this hour. In Jesus' name. In Jesus' name. Jesus' name. Amen. God be the glory.